Am I audible to you, sir? Sir? Am I audible to you, sir? Devashish sir, is it audible?
यस मैम, योर वॉइस इज ऑडिबल। सर म्यूट अच्छा मैं सर को कॉल कर दो जाओ तो मैम।
Yes, sir, please do call him so that we can start the session. Devashish sir, had you had a conversation with Kamdev sir? Devashish sir? Hello? Hello, Devashish sir?
Yes ma'am.
Yes sir, had you had a
Yes ma'am.
conversation with us with sir?
Yes.
Okay, Kamdev sir has joined, I think so. So, good morning to one and all. I, Hiba Farin, an academic consultant in English, works at Odisha State Open University. Would like to introduce Dr. Kamdev Sahu, sir, who would be taking an online session on the aspects of language and who has taken this great opportunity of handling the class. So, I would request Dr. Kamdev Sahu, sir, to kindly start the session. Hello, Kamdev Sahu, sir, where are you? Devashish sir, would you intervene and check it out whether he's able to unmute his mic and all that?
सर सर अनम्यूट करंतु आपनकर जो लेफ्ट साइड बटनटा अछि सर। हेलो सर आपन सर आपन वॉइस आसुनी। हेलो
हेलो
यस सर, गुड मॉर्निंग सर, यस सर, वी आर ऑडिबल। Has he left?
सर द लेफ्ट कर गले।
Could you please call him up and check it out? Where is he and all that?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir. Sir, kindly unmute your mic so that we can start the session, sir. Sandeep, sir. Hello. Am I audible to you, sir?
To you, but I am audible to you. But are you audible to me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Then we start. Okay.
Okay, sir. So I have already introduced you, but again I am introducing you.
No. Let me start. You just say if there is any problem, tell me. Okay.
By the end of the session, we will having the question answer session. So. Yes, sir. Please do start.
Good morning, participants. Say, I think I am audible. Today we'll be discussing morphology. In the meantime, I have been told that you have already been taught the fundamentals of linguistics, that is linguistics as a science of language, and the different aspects, and then also you have been taught phonetics, different branches of linguistics like phonetics, then phonology and phonotactics. Apart from that, the other branches are morphology, then morphophonology or morphophonemics, then syntax, and then semantics. So far as all these branches are concerned, you must be very, very clear about the connotation and the meaning of these branches. Phonetics deals with the study of sounds of a language. That means the different sounds of a language are classified and described. So far as phonology is concerned, it is different. It deals with the sound system of a language. That means how the different sounds join to make a language or make an utterance. And these sounds then are called phonemes of that language. See, sounds of a language, phones. When it comes to sound system of a language, they are phonemes. So the phonemes are the minimal sound unit of a language. Remember, the minimal or the minimum sound unit of a language. That means we cannot split into further parts. Pa or ba, these sounds are there, means pa cannot be split into different parts. So that is funny. Of course, allophonic variations are there. They might have already taught you, so I'm not going to say into that. Allophonic variations are there, how one phoneme operates in different situations and it has different characteristics. Allophonic variations. Another branch is there, that is called phonotactics. So far as phonotactics is concerned, it deals with the syllables of a language. Syllables. What is a syllable or what are syllables? Because in traditional grammar also, we discuss or talk about syllables, and which will be very, very important in morphology also. The syllables are, please remember, the syllables are the minimal sound segment of a language. See, phonemes are the minimal sounds of a language. But syllables are the minimal sound segments. That means two or more, one or two or more say sounds, they join to form a segment. It's a most important characteristic is that it contains a vowel. It contains a vowel. So when a word is divided into different syllables, we take or we count the vowels in that word and say that this word has this number of syllables. And accordingly, a word can be said to be a monosyllabic word having one syllable, for example, go, cat, play, etc., etc. Or disyllabic word, conduct, player, etc., etc. Or trisyllabic, or polysyllabic, like that, more than 3, 4, 5, etc., etc. So the syllable, in the syllable, the vowel is at the center. Of course, there are certain syllables which do not contain vowels, and even then we call them syllables, but they are not full syllables, they are called syllabic consonants. In the meantime, you must have been taught about phonemic transcription. Phonemic transcription means writing a word with the sounds of that word, with the help of the sounds of that word. And when we write that word with the help of the sound, for example, cat, if I write cat like ka and then a and then ta, that is cat, and that is called a phonological word. Remember, it is a phonological word when the word is written in terms of its sounds, with the help of its sounds. Phonological word. But if I write cat as C-A-T, it is called orthographic word. Okay, so phonological word, orthographical word, orthographic word means say how we write. We write with the help of the sounds, phonological word. We write with the help of the letters of the language, it is orthographic word. So far as syllables are concerned, as I told you, I come to syllabic consonant once again. For example, there is a word table. Table, if I make phonemic transcription, ta, then the diphthong a, then ba, then la, table. So te is one syllable, full syllable, and bl, bl, bl can be considered a syllable, and that kind of a syllable, because it doesn't contain a vowel, this is called a syllabic consonant. Syllabic consonant. So accordingly now, my dear friends, then we can say, so far the words are concerned, there are different types of words, such as monosyllabic word, disyllabic word, trisyllabic word, tetrasyllabic word, or polysyllabic word. Okay, so far as the syllables are concerned, they are not meaningful, or they are grammatically not important. They are only sound segments. They have nothing to do with grammar. Now when we come to morphology, as I told you, morphology deals with the structure of the words. It is the study of the internal structure of words. So today we will try to discuss words, the different types of words, and then try to identify morphemes. Because you see, so far as the word is concerned, it is a misnomer, sentence or word or a clause, etc., etc. In traditional grammar, the definition is vague and we fail to understand. What is a word? We don't know. We know This is a word we can say, but if I ask you define word, then you will fumble. So we'll be discussing that today. We'll also be discussing word formation. Word formation, you know, by different means. All these come in the category of morphology. So far as word formation is concerned, we have compounding, then conversion, then back formation, reduplication, blends, clipping, acronym, etc. So we may not be able to discuss these things today because this will be a very, very long aspect. It will take time, so we may not be able to discuss all these things today. What I will confine myself today is what are the different types of words, and then what is your morpheme. If possible, I'll be discussing allomorphic variation. Like allophonic variations, we have also allomorphic variations. So far as the allomorphic variation is concerned, morphemes realized in different ways, and we call it a morphophonology. There is a branch like morphology, there is a branch called morphophonology. It deals with morphemes and allomorphic variations. I told you about the other branches of linguistics. Syntax deals with the sentence structure, semantics deals with meaning. So this is in a nutshell, say we have our theoretical linguistics. Now, when I talk of words, you must be referring to dictionary. Dictionary, the other name of dictionary is also lexicon. We call it lexicon because it deals with lexis. Lexis means word. Word means vocabulary. Same thing. Okay. So far as the entry in the dictionary is concerned, you will find the phonological or the orthographic word written there. The grammatical word, which I'll be telling you, is not mentioned there at the head. It is there subsequently. Okay, what is a grammatical word? A grammatical word is the different paradigms or different forms of one phonological or orthographic word. For example, main word, lexeme, we call it, L-E-X-E-M-E, lexeme, we call it. So far as the lexeme is concerned, for example, eat is the lexeme, eat. Then it has different inflections or different paradigms or different forms like eats, ate, eating, eating, etc., etc. So these are the grammatical forms. Or eating or ate are also called grammatical words. So we have a phonological word, we have orthographic word, we have grammatical word. In traditional grammar, of course, the modern grammar also agrees to that. All the words, when they are used in utterances or sentences, they are called parts of speech. You know, there are 8 to 9 parts of speech, like noun, pronoun, verb, adverb, adjective, conjunction, interjunction, preposition, etc., etc., all these. Okay. So, far as all these words are concerned, these words are divided into two categories. Remember, these words are divided into two categories. Category one is content word. At times they call lexical word, but I don't prefer using lexical word because you see all the words are lexemes. So content words, let us say a specific independent meaning, words having specific independent meaning. And these are the content words. All nouns are the content words. Then main verb, you have two types of verbs, I'll be telling you. Main verb or lexical verb, we call them, go, play, work, etc., etc., are the content words. Then adjectives, good, beautiful, etc., etc., they are the content words. And then adverbs. So nouns, main verb, lexical verb, adjectives, and adverbs are all content words. All other words, for example, pronouns, then you have your auxiliary verbs or the helping verbs, such as you see, you have primary auxiliary do, be, and have, and then modal auxiliary will, would, shall, should, can, could, may, might, must, all these things will work. So these are all in the category of structural words, we call them. Let us not call them even grammatical words, because you see, as I told you, so far as grammatical words are concerned, its meaning is different. Some people say, but let us not say that. Structural words, because they are used in the structure of a sentence. They are useful while we frame a sentence. So pronouns, then auxiliary verbs, then articles, then prepositions, all others, okay, conjunction, etc., etc. All these are structured words. So words are, one is a content word and the other is structure word. So words are concerned, again, we may say there is a difference of words, and we call them, one is homograms and the other is homophones. Remember homographs and homophones. What is a homograph? If two or more phonological words are represented by the same orthographic word. Phonological word, I think you understand. Orthographic word, I think you understand. Suppose two or more phonological words are there. READ. READ. This can be realized phonologically as read or as read. Like that, LEAD, LEAD, it can be realized phonologically like lead and like lead. So these words are called homographs. Which are homophones? Just the opposite. One phonological word may be represented by two or more orthographic words. For example, see, M-E-E-T, meet. M-E-A-T, two different words are two different orthographic words. One is M-E-E-T, meet, meeting, meet. And the other is M-E-A-T, goat meat or lamb meat, etc., etc., M-E-A-T. But so far as the pronunciation is concerned, meet. So two orthographic words, but one phonological word. Such examples we can take for homophones. They are homophones. Then homonyms, another is homonyms. What is a homonym? Two different lexemes and two different meanings. For example, bank, B-A-N-K, bank. These are two different lexemes. one is bank of the river, and the another is bank where we have financial transaction. Like that ear, the part of the body. Another meaning is a portion of a particular tree. Like that bat, a type of say animal, and then this cricket bat, etc. So here meanings are interrelated to each other. This is homonyms. So homophones and homonyms. Another, you must try to know. Another is polysemy, because this will come, this may come in the examination. Polysemy, only one lexeme, and the meanings are closely related. Two other meanings are there. For example, mouth. You see, I have my own mouth. I eat with the help of my mouth, and then the mouth of the river. So there is a very slight difference between homonyms and polysemy. Before coming to the main course of morphology, let me say another word. That is a syncretism. What is syncretism? See, when I told you that so far as verbs are concerned, verb paradigms are there, that means these are all inflections I'll be coming to, inflections, derivations, etc., etc. Those are affixes, I'll be coming to that later on. But so far as syncretism is concerned, there are certain words which are realized in the same way so far as the paradigms are concerned. For example, cut. Past is cut, past participle is also cut, 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 put, put, put. Such words are called syncretic words. We call them syncretism. So with this, now I will come to morpheme or morphology. As I told you, so far as but before coming to that, let us come to the meaning of or the definition of words. Please write one sentence. Whenever she has time, whenever she has time, Suman helps her younger brothers with their homework. Now we'll try to analyze this. So this is a sentence which is called a complex sentence. As you know, sentences are of different types. Of course, in different way, we categorize sentences. Here, simple sentence, complex sentence, compound sentence, and compound complex sentence. This sentence is a complex sentence. Like that, we'll be discussing, words are also simple words, compound words, complex words, and compound complex words. Words are also of four types, like sentences: simple, compound, complex, compound complex. Here is a complex sentence having one main clause and the other is subordinate clause. Whenever she has time, Suman helps her younger brothers with their homework. So far as this sentence is concerned, again, the sentence, one sentence or one clause has two parts. One is the noun phrase and the other is the verb phrase. Again, the verb phrase contains also noun phrase. We'll be discussing, so you'll be discussing these things when we say you will discuss syntax. But see, there one is Suman, another is helps, younger brothers, and homework. Then whenever. Whenever is a word, is it one word? Or is it a word which is formed by joining two words, when plus ever. See, when plus ever. Whenever. Like that helps. H-E-L-P, help plus else, S. Here, S you may say, doesn't carry. You see, you say it performs a grammatical function. It doesn't carry any meaning because in third person singular, we use verb as form. There is this, so far as the verb paradigms are concerned, you all know we'll be discussing that in lexi, say, when we discuss inflectional, say, affixes, they are suffixes, inflectional affixes. Verb, the lexical verb or the main verb has six forms, you know that. One is V0, for example, go, then V, S form, goes, then V, ing form, going, then V, ed form, went, then V, en form, gone. And then, of course, another form, two infinitive, we call also to go. So, go, goes, going, went, gone, to go. These are all the verb paradigms. They are inflections. They are inflections. And with the help of inflections, we form new words. We'll be coming to that later on. This word, help, helps, has two components. One is help and the other is s. Like that, younger has two components. One is young and the other is er. Then brothers has also two components. So far as the S of health and S of brothers are concerned, they are different. Because you see, in case of brothers, it adds meaning, plural meaning. Brother, then brothers. Then homework, H-O-M-E, home, W-O-R-K, work. So these are called compounds. Which are called compounds? If two lexemes, if two main words join, that means when they are separated, they become meaningful. They are also independent words. They are called, such a word is called a compound. In other case, it is called a complex. Okay, when a word is divided into two or more parts, all the parts are independently used as words or can be used as words, then that is a compound. In case there are two parts of a word, one part is a full word and the other part is only dependent, it performs a grammatical function, then that is a complex. Here, there is a very interesting case. For example, I will say carpet. Please mark the word carpet. C-A-R-P-E-T. Carpet. Carpet can be divided. So let us divide it. Divide carpet into two parts. One is car and the other is pet. Car has independent meaning. Pet has also independent meaning. Pet has also independent meaning. So, pet is a separate word, car is a separate word, but when they join, they do not make a compound. Very interesting, you see. They do not make a compound because carpet is again, it is not a compound, it is a single morpheme. It is a single morpheme. Because when we split carpet into car and pet, carpet has nothing to do with car or with pet. But in case of blackboard, blackboard, black and board, they retain their meaning in blackboard. So we have to find out and for that, you see, there is no specific rule. Like different questions may arise in our mind. We may be confused at times whether blackboard is one word or two words. whether it accept is one word, unacceptable is a single word, or what? So to explain these things, morphology or morpheme comes into picture. Because once you know what a morpheme is, which are free morphemes, which are bound morphemes, then these problems will not occur. Let me come to again morpheme now. As I told you, so far as the parts of words are concerned, before coming to morpheme, one more thing let me tell you. A few more things. For example, this ear in younger, ear is different from, for example, ear of brother. Because younger, we can divide it to young and ear. And that is a comparative case. But in case of brother, we can divide brother into broth and ear. So these two ears are different. But younger, taller, shorter, in those cases, ear are similar. So for that, let me tell you a few things. Please remember a few things. One, in order to identify parts that form the structure of a word, because you see, we'll be discussing the structure of a word today, and that is morphology. There are some criteria. Criteria number one is, please try to be a little bit careful. If a word is wholly made up of two or more smaller words, each smaller word constitutes a part of the word. That is, when and ever. So, in whenever, when is a part, ever is also a part, like that in case of homework. Second is, a word can be divided into two or more parts if the parts are such that they also occur in other words. Once again, a word can be divided into two or more parts if the parts are such that they also occur in other words, like younger, they are also in elder, like they say, shorter or taller, etc. Like that, in case of helps, works, plays, etc. Okay, so this is the second point. Third point, a portion of a word can be recognized as a constituent part. That means a constituent part of a word or a structural element, we call it, of the word, if it carries a clearly recognizable element of meaning. There is a clear recognizable element of meaning, and if it occurs in a number of words with the same meaning, like plural s, in case of brothers, in case of trees, in case of tables, etc. So you see, S here is a plural morpheme. The next one is, a portion of a word can also be recognized as constituting a part of the word if its meaning is not clearly recognizable, though meaning is not recognizable, but it performs a particular grammatical function every time it occurs in a word, like the third person singular S. Wherever it is there, it performs a particular grammatical function. Ram helps me, or she walks, she walks, Sita plays, etc. In case of third person singular, this S is always there and it performs the same function. It performs the same function. Now, let me come to this different morphemes. As I told you, so far as morphemes are concerned, once again, before coming to morpheme, let me once again tell you, so far as phonemes and morphemes are concerned, remember a phoneme is distinctive, it has no meaning. It has no meaning by itself, but it can bring about a difference in meaning, so far as phonemes are concerned. They are also minimal in the phonological structure, in the sound structure. But a morpheme, see, has a meaning of its own. Of course, many people say when they describe morpheme is a minimal meaningful. Many people say that in all cases, meaning is not important. They say that instead of saying a minimal meaningful unit in the grammatical system of a language, minimum meaningful or structural or grammatical unit. Instead of saying meaningful, if we say structural unit or grammatical unit, I think that is more appropriate. So a morpheme is a minimal meaningful oblique structural oblique grammatical unit of a language. That is the definition of morpheme. Now, as I told you, so far as say word formation is concerned in morphology, word formation from one word, different words are formed. Different words are formed, and first is affixes. Affixes, and you all know about affixes. Affixes are of two types. One is prefix, one is inflectional affix, and the other is derivational affix. Also, they can say divide affixes into two types, inflectional and derivational, I told you, as prefixes and suffixes. Suppose there is a root. If we add another structure after the root, then it is a suffix. If we add before that, then it is prefix. For example, allowed, disallowed. In allow, if I add this is a prefix. Okay. But if I say meaningful, full is a suffix. Full is a suffix. So a word has prefixes as also has suffixes. A word also, a word can have prefixes, can have suffixes. But these prefixes and suffixes, so far as affixes are concerned, as I told you, they are divided into inflectional suffixes. All inflections are suffixes, remember. All inflections are suffixes. Derivations may be suffixes, may be prefixes. Remember once again, all inflections are suffixes only. That means after the root, we add inflections. But so far as the derivations are concerned, derivations can be prefixes, can be suffixes. Let me give you one example. Except. Except is the root. Okay, we call the base is the root. That means except we cannot split into further parts. It is a morpheme, a single morpheme, a word. A single morpheme forming a word is called root. And when we add something, some affix to that root is also called stem. Remember, same root becomes stem, and then to the stem we add affixes. Now, except. we can add able, acceptable. This is not an inflection. This is a derivational suffix. And then we can also add on, unacceptable. This is a derivational prefix. So far as the inflections and derivations are concerned, the basic difference between inflections and derivations are, in case of inflections, there is no change of class. No change of class means, if it is a noun, if the noun is the root or the stem is a noun. See, root or stem, where I said, when say the base is the root, but when we add something to that root is called a stem. Of course, after adding an affix, again, if we add another affix, that can also be called stem. For example, in unacceptable, accept is a root. Acceptable, when it becomes acceptable, accept is the root, able is the suffix, derivational suffix, and then acceptable becomes a stem again. Okay, accept is the stem, the root becomes stem, accept plus able is acceptable. So accept is here is stem and able is the suffix. Now when on is added, acceptable is called the stem. Accept was the stem earlier. Now acceptable is the stem. And on is added. So on acceptable is the new word, new complex word. It is called a complex word. But see, accept plus able, acceptable, accept is the root, accept becomes stem, then acceptable is the new word, acceptable becomes again stem, and to acceptable stem, we add on, then it becomes unacceptable. So far as we'll be discussing in detail later on, but I am just telling you that so far as derivations are concerned, derivations can be suffixes, can be prefixes, I told you. Derivations also can be class maintaining and class changing. Please write, derivations can be class maintaining and class changing. What do you mean by that? If the, for example, accept is what? Accept is a verb here, I accept something. Of course, use it in other parts of speech also, different thing. So accept, then when we add able, acceptable, it becomes adjective. So verb changes into adjective. So acceptable in acceptable, able is a class changing derivational suffix. See, able is a class changing derivational suffix. But in case of on, acceptable, unacceptable, no change of class is there. So it is a class maintaining derivational suffix. Prefix. Derivational prefix. So we'll be discussing derivations later on. Now let us come to inflections. And inflection, it is very interesting. For example, let us say the plural morpheme. Okay. Let us say the plural morpheme, it can be realized so far as in terms of writing it, or in terms of in phonological terms. For example, there are three. One is let me say cat. The plural is cats. Cat. The plural morpheme, here I am adding plural morpheme. The plural morpheme of cat is cats, sir. saw is the what? Saw is the sound. Okay, cats, we call it cats. Then if it is dog, we add saw plural, we make dog plural. What happens? It doesn't become ducks. It becomes what? It becomes dogs. Job. Okay. It becomes dogs. Then, suppose church or horse. Church or horse. Okay. Church or horse. Church, it doesn't become church or horses. No, it doesn't become that. Church becomes church. Eja. Church becomes church. Eja. And horse becomes horse. Eja. See, the same plural morpheme, the same plural morpheme is realized as saw. Is realized as easier as in case of church, churches, or horse, horses. So rose, roses, rose, roses. So many examples are there. Rose, roses, roses. And also, very interesting, there are other, for example, so deer is there. Deer, plural is deer. That means zero morpheme, zero allomorph, no change. Again, you see, we can replace certain, say, sounds, like, you know, foot becomes what? Feet. Means U is replaced by E in the middle. That is there. Again, addition, you see, replacement and addition, child becomes children, child, I becomes E, and then Aryan is added. Ox becomes oxen. So all these variations, you know, so far as the plural morpheme is concerned, these variations are called allomorphic variations. They are called allomorphs or allomorphic variations, we call them. Okay, allomorphs or allomorphic variations. So also in case of past tense, you have what happens? You have also change. You see, there is no change. For example, put, walk becomes walked. Play becomes played. So changes are there. Now, let me just give you the examples of some words which can be what? Structure can be identified. Okay, we can identify structure in which way? Remember, say there is a reverse tree diagram. Say, let us say, for example, write unknowingly. Unknowingly, when you are analyzing the word unknowingly, how are you going to analyze? Unknowingly, you divide into on. Okay, first on. And then on, when it is a prefix, after the prefix, there is a hyphen. When you are writing, after the prefix, there is always a hyphen. So, on plus mainly. In case of suffix, before the suffix, you have a hyphen. Knowingly again is divided into two parts. One is knowing and the other is ly. Then knowing is divided into two parts. One is know. And the other is ing. I have forgotten to tell you one thing. That so far as prefixes and suffixes, affixes are concerned, there are two types, I said, prefixes and suffixes. But remember, another, you say, oh, though it is not there in English or not there in Ubiya, there are certain Arabic languages where you have an infix also. Infix means in the middle, you know, you can insert. That is infix. Of course, it is not very important because so far as infixes are concerned, they are not very important because in English, in Odia, in Hindi, in Sanskrit, infixes are not there. So that's why it is not necessary. Now, let me give you example of another word. Or before say coming to another word, let me tell you, so far as morphemes are concerned, when we talk of morphemes are concerned, morphemes are of two types. One is free morpheme, right? One is free morpheme, and the other is bound morpheme. Which is a free morpheme? If the morpheme becomes a root or can operate independently, and or there is, you cannot split into, say, automatically you can't split that into two parts. So free morpheme, the bound morpheme, for example, in play is the free morpheme. So S is the bound morpheme. It is a plural morpheme or third person singular morpheme. These are all bound morpheme because they are dependent on the free morpheme. They cannot operate separately. They cannot operate in isolation. So free morpheme is there. Then bound morpheme is there. So far as the bound morphemes are concerned, as I told you, they are affixes. Here they are affixes. Affixes are maybe prefixes, maybe suffixes. And then so far as infixes are concerned, you can say that there can be infixes also, because in some languages infixes are there. So prefixes are there, suffixes are there. Then so far as the prefixes are concerned, they are all always derivational. Prefixes cannot be inflectional, remember. Prefixes cannot be inflectional. They are always derivational. And these derivational prefixes can be class changing, can be class maintaining. Class changing, if the part of speech changes, class changing. Okay, if the part of speech doesn't change, then that is class maintaining. Okay, so far as the suffixes are concerned, suffixes are of two types. One is inflectional and the other is derivational. That means inflectional suffixes and derivational suffixes. So far as the derivational suffixes are concerned, they can be class changing, they can be class maintaining, but so far as inflections are concerned, they are always class maintaining. Inflections do not change the class. Inflections happen in four cases. One is, for example, in case of nouns, you know, plural is there. There means say tree, trees, and then apostrophe, say S genitive, we call it apostrophe S. That is also an inflection. Okay, apostrophe S. So that is in case of noun. Then in case of adjective, you know, good, better, best, etc., etc. This in adjective it is there. Then in adverbs also it is there. And then in pronouns also it is there. He, his, him, etc., etc. He, his, him, etc., etc. And so far as the verbs are concerned, as I told you, verb paradigm, go, goes, going, went, gone, these are all inflections. These are all inflections. Okay. For example, in case of is, am, are, was, were, been, being, etc., etc. So all these are inflections and others are derivations. Let me give you one more example, of dividing the word into different parts. Dehumanization. Please write one word. Dehumanization. Dehumanization. How to split dehumanization into different parts? You can't say de and humanization. You have to split into dehumanize first and son then. Okay, the stem is dehumanized, then the suffix is tion, and it is a class changing and derivation in case of dehumanization. Then again, dehumanize is the stem. You split that into two parts. One is a D and the other is humanize. So humanize is the stem and D is the prefix. And what kind of prefix it is? It is class maintaining. That means humanize and dehumanize, they don't change their class. Okay. Same class. So that's why D is a class maintaining derivational prefix. Remember, in dehumanize, D is a class maintaining derivational prefix. Humanize is a what? Class. It's a humanize is a stem. Is the stem. Then this humanize again, you can divide into two parts. One is the stem human that becomes the root. Okay, this stem also is the root. Root, I think you understand now that you see the first morpheme, okay, which is which becomes the stem, okay, is the root. Okay, so root, and to that root IJD is added, and IJD humanized, because there is a change in class. It is a class but changing derivational suffix. Okay, class changing derivational suffix. Now you see, I'll give you a few words to try, you know, at home also. Try at home. That is, one is computerizes. Please write computerizes and try to split it into its morphemes. And then next is entrenchment. Another entrenchment. Okay, you try it. Entrenchment. Some other words also I'm giving you. One is rebroadcast. Rebroadcast. Then there are certain compounds. Okay, this is the these are of course complex compound words. Dry cleaner. Because in cleaner, there is a, you know, this complex element. That's why it is called dry cleaner. It is a complex compound word. So dry cleaner. Then elevator operator, E-L-E-V-A-T-O-R, elevator operator, O-P-E-R-A-T-O-R, elevator operator. One more word, enthusiastically, E-N-T-H-U-S-I-A-S-T-I-C-A-L-L-Y, enthusiastically. So these are a few words. I would like you to practice at home. Once again, let me tell you a few things before summing up. As I told you, so far as morphology is concerned, once again, let me bring about this plural morphemes. I told you that how the plural morphemes are realized in different ways. If say I didn't tell you that, you see, cat, ta is a voiceless consonant. Before this voiceless say consonant, if after the voiceless consonant, if we add sa, it becomes cats. But in case of dog, ga is a voiceless voiced consonant, it becomes a dog. In case of roj, ja, cha, ja, sha, ja. If these sounds are there, that becomes ija, ija, and these are allophonic variations. Particularly in case of nouns, we have allophonic variations. Also, in case of verbs, we have, as I told you, past. In case of past, we have ida, we have da, and we have ta. Okay, we have ida, we have da, we have ta. Let me give you examples of words. Wait. Wait becomes waited. Ida. Wait becomes waited. Ida. Then rage becomes raged. Da. Okay. Rage becomes raged. Da. Then race becomes raged. Da. So past morpheme can be realized in terms of ida, da, or ta. So, of course, there are rules for that also. If you pass this, let me give you the rules of this, because these are also allomorphic variations. So far as the past tense ida is concerned, that is realized each ed, ed. Okay, ed, wait, waited, wait, ed, raised, raced. In spelling, all are ed. Okay, so this ed is realized as id. Ida, that means waited. Yeah, if it is preceded by, remember, ta or da. If it is preceded by ta or da, it becomes waited or like that. If it is preceded by a voice sound, that means a vowel or a voiced consonant other than da, then it is realized as da. Once again, as I am telling you, if it is preceded by a voiced sound, that means a vowel or a voiced consonant other than da, it is realized as da. And if it is preceded by a voiceless consonant other than ta, it is realized as ta. Okay, so look, looked, laugh, laughed, etc., etc. So past has three allomorphic variations here, particularly in this case. Of course, zero variation is also that is called zero allomorph, put, or replaceive allomorph, as I told you earlier. Okay, child, children, ox, oxen, foot, feet, etc., etc. These are called replaceive allomorphs. Replaceive allomorphs. So far as past is concerned, ida, da, or ta. In case of sheep or deer, you see, this is called zero allomorph. Zero allomorph. So, I think I would like to wind up, and we can take some questions. Okay, Eva? Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir.
I think for about a few minutes we can take questions.
Yes, sir.
A bit technical you see what happens, this one-sided teaching is a bit difficult so far as this technical topics are concerned. Okay. Hello.
Yes, sir. Sir, mo madam kouchi questions read koribe apno answer de.
Thank you. क्वेश्चन लिखे जाने से चलेगी।
Yes, sir.
Yes.
I would request the participants to kindly unmute their mic one by one and directly interact with the resource person so that question your question might be clear to the resource person. Okay. Participants, kindly unmute my mic one by one. Okay. Don't create a rush over there, else you won't be getting the questions clearly answered. Right. Participants, if you are having any query, then please do ask questions. Because attendee can't kindly unmute your mic and directly interact with the resource person. Because Sandy. Yes, sir. His question is, how many morphemes are there in assertion, sir?
Assert.
How many?
Only two. Assert and tion. Assertion. Assert is the root. It becomes a stem and it is assertion. Okay, yes, assertion. Morphemes and syllables, please don't confuse. Assertion has three syllables, but it has two morphemes. One free morpheme, that is assert, and the other is bound morpheme, that is tion. Okay?
Yes, sir. Any more questions? Participant, please do write the questions at least. Or do kindly interact.
Ma'am, there are another two questions in chat box.
Actually, I am not getting the questions, okay? So if you are having them, please do. I'm not having the question in the screen. It's deleted, I think.
Yes, ma'am. Theek hai, main copy karke paste kar deta hun wo question.
Okay, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir. The question is, what is a syllable and how to describe the types? What is a syllable and how to describe its types?
Yes, all right. You see, a syllable, remember, a syllable is a minimal, distinctive sound segment of a language. Okay, sound segment means one or two or three sounds, they join to make a syllable. Okay, so for the syllables are concerned, I didn't say discuss syllables. The syllables can be stressed syllables and unstressed syllables. Okay, stressed means accented. For example, in case of conduct, it is a disyllabic word having two syllables. If it is noun, the stress is on the first syllable, come. Duct. Okay, conduct. If we change the stress to the second syllable, it becomes verb conduct. Okay, conduct. So far as syllables are concerned, as I told you, one syllable has a vowel, or and then a one or more than one preceding consonants or one or more than one following vowels. That is, the vowel is the nucleus, and we have preceding consonants, okay, and they are called onset, and following consonants, they are called coda. Okay, so this is the structure of a syllable: C, V, C, or C, C, V, C, 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 etc., etc. C means consonant, V means vowel. So you see, the syllables may be stressed, may not be stressed, and taking that into consideration, we arrange the stressed and unstressed syllables so that we get rhythm in language. Okay, tit-tum, 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 etc. Go and thirst the car. Okay, go and thirst the car. So this is one way of dividing syllables into two categories. One is a stressed syllable and the other is unstressed syllable. The other one is, if there is no vowel, and still then if we want to call it a syllable, like in table or cotton, etc., etc., that means there are two consonants, a cluster of consonants, and these cluster of consonants are called a syllable, then we call it a syllabic consonant. It is not a full syllable, it is a syllabic consonant. So that's why a syllable must have a vowel, and then one or more consonants. Consonants are not compulsory. Only one vowel can be a syllable, but more consonants are there. Without a vowel, if there are a cluster of consonants, they are called not full-fledged vowels, sorry, syllables, they are called syllabic consonants, like in table, bull, or cotton, ton, tea, top, and noun. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Sir, someone is asking that, will you please be able to give the example of infix? There are suffixes, prefixes. He is asking to give
an example. In Arabic, it is there. In Arabic, infix is there. Find out one. Word infix. For example, from English we cannot give examples. Okay, there are infixes only in languages like Arabic and Tagalog. Tagalog is another. So in Tagalog, for example, there is a word called umilit. Right? Tell them to write o u ma e long e. Then la, then e, then ta. Okay, this is the phonological or transcribed way, which means one who compared. Humilit in Tagalog means one who compared or one who takes effort. It consists of a stem and an infix. What is the stem? Pilit is the stem. Right, pa, long e, la, short e, and ta. Pilit is the means effort, and the infix is om, um. In case of infix, you make the hyphen both the sides. Okay, beginning and end, because it is infix. Infix. So um is the infix. There is the example of infix. Okay, in Tagalog and Arabic only infixes are there. In English, my dear friend, there is no infix. Yes
sir. Thank you, sir. I would request Vikas Tandy to kindly unmute his mic so that your question would be much more clear, as I don't think I would be able to make it much more clear to the resource person. He is asking that, how is compound noun defined in CGEL? Sir, he is asking that, how is compound noun defined in CGEL?
CGEL means?
He hasn't specified. That's why I'm asking him to directly interact with the resource person.
Actually, a compound noun is a noun when we split into morphemes. So for example, is a noun of two or more morphemes which can be operated as free morphemes. That means two or more free morphemes when joined, they form a compound. Okay. Bound morpheme is there, means it is not a compound. Only free morpheme plus free morpheme. Black, bird, etc. Dry, yes. Clean, etc.
So can we take the next question? Someone is asking that suffix ly that is used in word like happily, beautifully, rapidly. These are
derivational class changing derivational suffixes. Class changing because happy, happily, class is changed. Okay, and ly is always a derivation, and because you see after that it is a suffix. Very simple. Okay, class changing derivational suffixes. Clear?
Yes, sir. Participants, if you're having any more questions, and please do text or directly interact. As we are left with few more minutes, else we will be winding up the session. Participants, please do ask your questions. Participants haven't yet texted any questions, so we think we can wind up the session, sir.
No problem. Okay, no question.
One more question we got by the end. One is asking that how to differentiate between compound and complex words.
Yes, same thing. Compound words means combination of free morphemes. Okay, free morphemes, and complex words are a combination of free and bound. Bound morphemes means a morpheme is always dependent on the other. For example, LOI, LESS, or UN, these are bound morphemes, or the inflections, S, or ING, ED, etc., etc. Bound morphemes. Okay. They cannot operate as words separately. Okay. So, a complex word is a combination of free and bound morphemes. A compound word is a combination of free morphemes only. More than one
female. Yes, sir. And simple is the basic word or anything else? Yeah, a person is asking that simple is a basic word or anything else? Simple
is a free morpheme and it is a word. So, okay, it is a, we call it lexeme. Okay, a lexical word or a lexeme. Simple. See, from simple, we can say simply, simplicity, simplified. These are all complexes. From the word simple, root simple, if we make simple a stem, then these words can be what? Realized or formed. They are simply, simplified, simplification, simplifying, all these.
Yes, sir. A person is asking, noble, can it be split into morphemes? A word what? Noble word can be split into...
No. Noble is a free, it is a lexeme, it is a free morpheme. Okay, it's a root. It cannot be we can't split a noble into morphemes. Okay. Nobility. Okay, from noble, I-T-Y, you add I-T-Y, nobility.
Yes, sir.
Nobly. These things you can know. Yes.
Yes, sir. Would you be able to please explain us what is polyseme? Polyseme.
Polyseme, you know, you see only one lexeme polyseme, you know, that is only one lexeme, but meanings are closely related. That means there is a difference between homonyms and polysemy. Okay. So far as polysemy is concerned, let me tell you, mouth. Mouth is the mouth of the river and mouth of the body. Okay. That is an example of a polysemy. But you see, both are closely related. Meaning is closely related. Okay. Whether it is the mouth of the river or mouth of the body, you see, beginning, base. Almost meaning is closely related. But in case of homonyms, what happens? Two different meanings. Okay. Bank. Okay. Bank, river bank, or where we transact money, bank. That is homonyms. Okay. So, though here two meanings, there also two meanings. But in case of homonyms, they are, the meanings are though interrelated to each other, they are two different lexemes. But in case of polysemy, it is one lexeme. Okay. Polysemy is one lexeme. Homonyms are two lexemes. Mouth is one lexeme. But bank or bed, two other lexemes. Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes. And now I think nobody has written questions yet.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
So thank you, sir, for such a wonderful lecture from the phonemic
institute. See, actually, it's my first ever.
Yes, sir.
I'm not accustomed to this virtual classes, because I am accustomed to asking questions and then you see what in the classroom interacting with the students. So yes, that's why I like to develop the habit of taking this virtual classes. I think I shall have to repeat things. I didn't repeat today much. I think I shall have to repeat things, or else students may not be able to understand. Okay. All right.
Yes, sir. I would like to.
Were you listening?
Yes, sir. Am I audible to you, sir?
Were you listening to me during my class?
Yeah, I was there, but the mute mic wasn't. I wasn't able to unmute it. So I would like to say that the very lecture that provided on phoneme transcription, be it the content word and the functional word, and the very morphological aspect that you tried to took up and make it much more simpler for the learners. It was really a commendable job. And I, on the behalf of the participants, would like to thank you. And we are looking forward for future much more lectures like this. So please do.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.